Joe King. I put his name up. We're a little early tonight. We were a little early last week. Deal with it. It's just the way it's going to have to be. It's a miracle that I can even do this, let alone get a guest on. So expecting me to do this on time is just asking a little bit too much. But Joe was going to be our first guest a while back, and I just didn't have it together. I needed to be on a wired connection. I was on Wi-Fi, and it wasn't cutting it. But it seems fine to me. So if you're watching this and you're in the chat room, pipe up. Let me know if you can hear us, if you can see us, and if everything looks and sounds good to you. And in the meantime, Joe King is a guy I've known for many moons now, going back to, I guess, probably 1990 when
That's right.
Went to my mailbox, my post box in Prospect Heights, Illinois, and got a package with a record in it, The Queers, Grow Up. There were like, I don't know, 200 of them pressed or something. And
that's right. Yeah, you got the vinyl. That's right. You got the vinyl.
Yeah, it was signed. I still have it. It was signed by Joe King and B-Face and Hugh, neither of who actually played on the record. But
well, Hubie was on some of it.
Oh, yeah, he was. Okay.
B-Face probably wasn't born by the time we tracked that the first time, but anyway.
But it was funny because I talk about this a lot. Thank you, Tonal Annihilation. He can hear both of us. Hiya, right, John M. Hiya, Boiler Punk. I think Boiler Punk is from Indiana, too. Joe was just telling me he's working on a record with his roadie or somebody who is from Indianapolis. Is he a roadie?
Say hi. This is Nicotine right here.
Hey, what's
he's
up?
He's down from Indianapolis. Hey, so.
Indianapolis, yeah. There's a place you never want to go back to after you've been there once, huh?
That's right.
So, it's not bad.
It's pretty bad. So I got this record in the mail from a stranger, and I was, at the time I was living in Wisconsin. My parents had moved to Wisconsin because that was the only way they could get me to move out of their house. And little did they know I would end up following them up there a year and a half later. But I would come down on the weekends, get my mail, have band practice, and I would stay at my girlfriend's mother's house. And I remember taking this record and putting it on the turntable in the basement. I listened to the record over and over and over for like half a day. I just listened to this record over and over and over because there was virtually nobody contemporary. There was really nobody contemporary of ours that was doing that kind of stuff, and I was like, yeah, man, that's what I want to do. And so that's how I kind of met Joe King. He sent me a record, which, by the way, is not an invitation for anybody else to ever send me a record, because it's never, ever happened again where it worked out that yeah. way, ever. It's never happened, so don't send me your stuff. But anyway, how did you run across my address?
I remember this. B-Face and I used to, I was living in Dover, New Hampshire at the time, and my roommate Marna was DJ at UNH. So she played something off Boogada, and B-Face and I would go up and drink beer and, you know, hang out. And so they played something off Boogada, whatever it was, and we loved it. And then, so we were really into it. All of a sudden, we're like, Screeching Weasel, my God. You know, as soon as we saw I Hate Led Zeppelin, I go, B-Face, I love these guys. You know, we just had to see I Hate Led Zeppelin. I was like, this is great. So we got off that first a vinyl, Doug Ward's thing. So a number was on the original run. So we're like drunk, you know, we're like, Ben Weasel. I left a message, and then I guess apparently Doug had called you or something, said these nuts are trying to get in touch with you. You might owe him $5 or something. And then I remember coming home one time to my folks' house with B-Face, and my dad had left a message. Ben Weasel called. And we're like, dude, Ben Weasel, this is great, dude. And I remember that. That was from, when they had the phone, Doug's phone number on the album.
You know, it's funny because I don't know why. I don't know why that would have been. But anyway. It might have been Dave Best. It might have been the record label. Because we were helping him with the record label, and I think he used to put the phone number on everything. So maybe that happened.
I swear to God, it was Doug Ward, though. And that was I really remember Doug Ward. And because I met him afterwards, I swear it was Doug's number. Anyway, whatever.
One of the funny things is, or one of the interesting things, or coincidental things maybe, is that when I was first getting into punk, I was living up in sort of a what everybody called rehab. It wasn't really drug rehab, but it was one of those old therapeutic communities, kind of a cross between a group home and a detention center. And up in Maine, in Poland, Maine, where the Poland Spring Water comes from.
That's right.
And one of the guys I was in there with, Brian Demerit, for some reason got frequent home visits, and he was from Dover. And most of the time, you'd be there for 2 years, you'd get maybe two home visits. I got two in 2 years. But for some reason, maybe because he was close by, I don't know, but he would go home like once a month. And he knew I liked punk, and he would tape the all-ages show on UNH for me, and I would get these tapes. And that was a great show, man. They played everything from, you know, that was the first time I heard the Angry Samoans, Verbal Assault. I don't know if you remember them from they were like from D.C., I think. Somewhere on the East Coast. That band, nobody's ever heard of them before except you, probably. The PTL Club, you remember them?
Yes, of course, yeah.
What was their song? Drinking and Driving. It was a pro drinking and driving song. And they were all in character. They did an interview on UNH, and they were all in character. And they talked like this. This song is called Drinking and Driving, and it's about drinking and driving.
The PTL Club. I remember them, of course. Yeah.
I think it was the PTL Club. Yeah, so anyway, I heard a lot of the stuff that got me into punk, and the great thing about that show and a lot of the shows on college radio in those days was they didn't just play hardcore or punk. They'd play all kinds of fringe stuff. So they were playing stuff like off the 100 Flowers record. You remember that? The Urinals changed their name to 100 Flowers. And they put out, I think, a self-titled LP. I'm sure I still have that somewhere. They had a great song on there called California's Falling Into the Ocean. I first heard that there. You know, all kinds of really great stuff. So it was kind of funny. And then on our first tour, we drove out to the East Coast because we couldn't get any shows along the way. This is in December of 88. And so we played Worcester, Mass. To like three people. It was Al Quint from Suburban Voice had some band. And he set up a show, and there was nobody there. And then his band played, and he left along with everybody else. So that was our first show. And then the next day we did a community radio station in Worcester with Anal Cunt. We had never heard of them before.
They were all part. You got in with the Psycho crowd, Al Quint and Psycho and Anal Cunt and all those guys.
I didn't know the guys from Psycho. I mean, we just fell into that. I didn't know the guys from Psycho. I saw them play, I think about 6 months later, I saw them open up. They were also in a band called, I want to say, Cancerous Growth. And it was the same members, and they sounded exactly the same.
Yeah.
But they had to have two bands. So Psycho and Cancerous Growth opened for the Rollins band. It would have been like 88, 89. So I saw that show in Chicago. But anyway, our third show, Joe, was up at Geno's in Portland, Maine.
Yeah.
We get up there. The club's not open yet. It's December, so it's cold outside. And we found, you know, this local paper. And on the front was, you know, the cover story was about this local Nazi skinhead. And all this abuse he was taking from people for being a Nazi skinhead, like, you know, people throwing stuff at his house and so forth. So they finally open the club. We go in. Nobody's there, of course. Okay, another night we're going to play to the sound man. Guy shows up. It's the guy from the cover story. It's the Nazi.
Yeah.
And a couple years later, we met him again because he showed up at your house with the Bruisers, whose singer ended up in the Dropkick Murphys. But he was there.
Was that Sick Rick? That was Sick Rick, right? He was in the band Hate Factor. That was it. Nobody hates you like the Factor. I remember that was the thing. The thing is, he met us, right? This is right before I met you when I had my restaurant. And Rick turned out to be, you know, we kind of started hanging out with, and then the whole Nazi thing, you know what I mean? He turned out to be a sweetheart.
Yeah, I think he got the swastikas covered up.
Yeah, exactly. And he unfortunately died, but he was just a wonderful guy. But we were part of that transformation. He finally realized, you know, when you're young, you don't know shit from your hole in the ground, and as Babbitt would say. And you know, he turned out to be a nice guy, but that was Sick Rick. Yeah, man, he was something else. Well, I gotta tell you this story. So we go up and we're playing this place in Portland called the Cybernaculum, Scummy's Place. And we go up there. It's me, Johnny Rio, who's in Teenage Glue Sniffer, who's in Street Dogs, and B-Face and someone else, Bryn Johnson, my roadie. And at the time. We go up there, right? We go up there, and then one of the guys gets in the pit. This guy, Itch, gets in the pit. He was with us, too. He goes in, and then he's leaning up against the thing. There's a huge pit. He's leaning up against a fucking big steel beam, and Sick Rick comes at him. Someone throws Sick Rick at him, and the guy was about 300 pounds. So Itch steps over, and Sick Rick goes full on into the beam, and I go, oh, my God, he's going to kill Itch. So we all jumped in there, and that's how I met Sick Rick. So, dude, I'm looking out. The next week, I look out the front door of my restaurant. It was a Saturday afternoon. Down the street, here comes that guy, Sick Rick. I couldn't believe it. We were terrified of him, and we became friends. But, you know, it was
fun. Well, it's funny, too, because that night, you know, he showed up to the show. God knows why he was there. And he was like, hey, you want to come stay at my house? I'm like, we just read about your house is under siege. We can stage your house. Plus, you're a Nazi. We can stage your house. Are you kidding me? We literally, Joe, slept in the van in the cold that night rather than stay at Sick Rick's house. But the funny thing, he was so nice. He was so polite. He was going to make us dinner, I think. And the other thing that was funny was that was actually the first time I heard of the Queers. You know, two years, probably a year and a half before I ever heard the Queers, because there was a weekly magazine up there, monthly magazine, like a local, you know, local music magazine, and on the cover was that photo of you from the cover of Grow Up, and it said, the Queers are back. And I'm like, whoa, what's this? This looks cool. And they're called the Queers. This is awesome. And I open it up, there's not a word in the entire magazine about you. That's the only thing. You made the cover and there was nothing inside about the band.
No, yeah, that's typical. There was a husband and wife up there. I lost touch with them, but they loved us. And they would do that stuff. I guess we were one of the few bands that would answer the phone. And so, they put us on the cover, no information.
Queers are back. And, you know, that also reminds me, that cover for Grow Up, which I love, it's a great... I think it's just an awesome record cover. And that was designed by Jack Stevenson. Was that his name? Jack Stevenson? Yeah. And he did the Pandemonium, I sound like an old lady. He did the Pandemonium. But he did what was it, like a fanzine? Because I had actually a collection. It was like bound, like a soft cover bound I think it was like an issue, but he did like this big issue, and he was kind of a graphic artist, and it was more along the lines, if I recall correctly, it was more along the lines of almost like those research things they used to put out, where he was really into weird film, and he wasn't just into punk, he was into all kinds of weird music and weird film. Like, I loved that stuff back then. Nobody does that anymore, it seems.
Yeah, he did. That's when it took some really sleuthing to find that stuff. He did. He knew Johnny Eck, the little half-man from Freaks.
Yeah.
I went to Jack's house, you're not going to believe this one, and he showed me letters. I actually, like, held letters and read them that he was pen pals with Manson.
Yeah.
And so he was showing me stuff that he got from Charlie Manson. I remember one of the lines was like, "I ain't your Y-O-R-E pen pal." And he goes, "I ain't no fast food fairy." And I told my buddy that that was a good band name, the Fast Food Fairies. But, yeah, he showed me all this stuff. He was friends with Hank Lee, but he was very good friends with, he knew John Waters very well. And he ended up moving. It was totally interesting, that pandemonium thing. And then he ended up moving over to Scandinavia someplace. Huh. And I lost touch with him. I last talked to him maybe 12 years ago, but he's over there somewhere.
Huh.
And, you know, he had to go all the way over there. He's so nerdy, you know, couldn't get laid in a chicken coop over here. So he went to Scandinavia where anything goes. And, he's over there now, but I guess he was doing the same thing, but he was a super interesting guy, dude.
Yeah. And I wouldn't have thrown it away. I've got to have a copy of that Pandemonium softcover thing somewhere. It was really, really well done, and it was really interesting. And I loved that there were people like that back then. When you know, you could pick up a fanzine and it could be anything inside. And I don't know. I guess things are better now that you can get anything and find anything with a click on the internet. That's convenient, but there was something kind of cool, almost like part of a secret society back then running across that Queers record. I mean, you sent me that Queers record. How many of those were pressed on the original pressing? It wasn't many, was it?
So Shaken Street did, they did, I think, 500, and then I was going to press 300 on Doheny, but they sent two boxes. And I only got, for some reason, it was COD, I didn't have the money, and they dropped off 180 of the vinyl, and the other 120 got crushed. So that's actually our rarest release, is the Queers Grow Up on Doheny with 200 copies. Though that first 7-inch, the We'd Ever Ride Doing Heroin, I just saw that thing went, a copy of that for $6,500 on eBay or
You've
something.
You've got to be kidding me.
No, I'm not, I'm dead serious. Someone sent me the link. Whenever it gets up that high, people will send me a link. I just saw it within the last 8 months. Someone sent me a link. $6,500. I gave those things away.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, well. Hey, if you have a question for Joe King from the Queers, rock legend, ask in the chat. And if it's not dumb, I'll ask him for you. Joe, I've been telling people for years. Nobody listens to me, but I've been telling people for years, you're one of the best songwriters I know. And when it comes to a certain kind of song, there's nobody your equal, in my opinion. When it comes to a certain kind of, mid-tempo to slower, almost ballad-esque kind of pop song, nobody does it like you. Nobody does it like you. So why haven't you done anything lately?
Probably because we've got about a million albums out now. We can't play half the songs we got now. We've got so many songs. So I don't know. We're going to do a new album here in the next few months. We're actually starting to, you know, work on tunes and stuff. So,
here's what you ought to do. And I've told you this before. Demo the songs. Send me the songs. I will produce this thing because I want, you know, I produced a couple Queers records.
That's right.
In the old days, that that wasn't producing. That was me sitting there trying to keep things on schedule, and failing. And but I really think that I could do. I mean, I've actually learned. And actually, the last Queers thing that I produced, I think I did some good work on that. The EP.
Yes, that was great. That came
Dangerous,
out great.
Was it Dangerous Dave on that lineup and Lurch?
Lurch and that kid Isaac, you know, we did that such good work that weekend. I was like, we were so close. We could have finished an album. I mean, if you had another few days, we could have I had a few ideas, but I was just in the groove. I know we could have finished an album.
It was coming along nicely. And I'm telling you, if you demo the stuff out, and I've got stuff, cause you asked me last week, you said somebody asked you to do a Christmas song and asked me if I had, I got this thing that I just wrote, and it's not a song. It's basically a verse, and it's awesome. Maybe it would fit with what you came up with. Let's finish it. Send me what you got, because I know you had asked about it, and I'm willing to do it. I'm happy to do it. But who asked you to do it anyway?
I gotta look it up. Some label. The guy just emailed me. I'll send it to you. I don't know who it is, but I've been wanting to write a Christmas song, but I've got this idea. I don't want to say the title, but I think it's going to be pretty cool because I was thinking about doing some. At first, I was working on something called Santa Claus and Joey Ramone, but it was, you know, it's too corny. And then this is like a Ramonesy thing. And I was like, okay, this is cool, but I'll send it to you. I think you'll like it. I really do. So I got a couple other songs. We want to do your song, The Bubblegum Girl. You know, you sing it and we'll record it. I'd love to do that.
Yeah, that's fine. I mean, that's basically like, that's basically my homage to Chewy Chewy. Right.
Yeah. No, and you, dude, you did it. I remember the day you wrote that. You called me up and you said, "Dude, I have written the best song I ever wrote." And I go, "Dude, I love that thing, man."
But you know what? I don't know if I would say that now. I think I've written better songs, but I'm not. I'm probably not going to do anything with it. So if you want it, it's yours. It's a good tune. I mean, it's
a great song. We should do it, and you should. You know, I can come up there or whatever. You should sing it. It would be cool, but.
Yeah, well, I mean, I do vocals right here in the office. Yeah. You know, I was telling you before we went live, I did the score essentially for that short film. And one of the things I did was I had a song, you know, I had a song that I've never recorded, and I sent it to the director and the guy I was working with on the music with and the producers and stuff. And I said, I don't know, maybe this would fit. And they're like, yeah, that's awesome. So I did the vocal for that right here in the office. And the stuff that I released, my Christmas song from a year ago last Christmas and my New Year's Eve song, I recorded the vocals right here.
Yeah, yeah.
Actually,
yeah.
I recorded them in my mechanical room. But, yeah, you know, standing yeah, next to the furnace. But I can do it. I mean, it's easy enough. But let's do, you know, Joe, you've been talking about, this is going back to the 90s. For those of you who are paying attention, you have been saying for years, oh, let's do a record together. Okay, let's do one. I mean, I don't know who's paying for it, but let's do one. I'm busy now, but I'm always busy. I can make time.
I mean, I wish I could get you down here. I am like busy.
Get me down there.
Huh?
You can.
Yeah, we got a big house. I mean, you know, we'd love to have you down. Richie's going to come out and do something. He actually, I just saw him a few months ago. So he's going to come out and just me and him are going to do something. I'll get Cheeto on bass. But I have been busy in the studio. I'm in the middle of something now. It's like unreal, man. But
Richie Ramone, great drummer. Best drummer that played in the Ramones, if you ask me, in terms of not only the technical prowess, but just in terms of, you know, his style fitting the band.
Oh, when he came in, man, I was so excited. Like any real Ramones fan, he was writing songs, he was singing. It was like, you know, it was cool. It was great when Richie joined. I was bummed when Marky came back because it was so exciting. You know, he did that song on his solo album that we were talking about called I Fix This. And he was showing me a couple of things. He was thinking that would have been a Ramones song or something.
That was an awesome tune.
Yes.
Did he release that?
He did it on his solo album, yeah. And I thought it was great on his last album he did. Yeah, he did. He is an amazing songwriter. Dude, if you listen to his song, I went to the studio, Kit and Robot, and we're talking about this project we were thinking of doing with CJ, me, you, and Richie. But anyway, he played me Paul Ressler, who was the keyboard player for the LA Screamers, going back, Tamata Duplenty. He played me a couple of things off Richie's album before it came out, but that song, like Cellophane off his album, listen to it. It's his last solo album. It could have been a song for Lita Ford with Ozzy type thing. I mean, it's amazing what he wrote. It's amazing. And these guys.
Yeah, Richie's good.
Yeah, but Richie, by the way, you know, Dusty Watson used to go out with Lita Ford. She put a book out, and she mentions him frequently. Get her book. It's a great read.
Really?
Yeah, Dusty's.
Yeah, Dusty Watson, for people paying attention, used to play with the Queers. He also played with Dick Dale, and I think now he's playing with the reformed
Sonics.
The Sonics, yeah. The name was escaping me. He's a fantastic drummer, and his wife has come up, and I know last time we played LA together, she came up and played, and she's in a band called the 210s. The 210s. So let's make a record together or something. Now, people have a couple of questions. One guy is just trying to hook up with you about, this is Chris Hansen, CD Hansen. This is Chris Hansen from Sacramento. I've been sending you punk acoustic songs throughout the years, working on pop music now. Good to see you. Okay. Haley Crusher from Haley and the Crushers wants to know what your secret is for surviving on the road. Do you bring veggies with you?
Yeah, only the two-legged kind, har har. But, I have lots of water. Lots of water and focus factor.
Joe, do you moisturize?
I moisturize my ass. Yes, it gets me through.
I moisturize. I've got to moisturize. I'm a gentleman of a certain age now. Speaking of which, I want to say this now because I'm going to forget otherwise. There will be no show next week. And I'll tell you why there will be no live stream next Tuesday. When you turn 50, two terrible things happen. Well, a lot of terrible things happen. But two particularly terrible things happen. They both involve things up your butt. And one is, you have to start getting a prostate exam. Now, it used to be every year, but now I think they say like every 3 or 5 years, thank God.
Yes.
So I had the prostate exam like a month ago, which, you know, and the doctor didn't even take me out to dinner afterwards. And and now next Tuesday, guess what? I turned 50 last year. Guess what? It takes forever to schedule up there. I get the colonoscopy.
Oh, boy.
So after that ordeal, that's in the morning on Tuesday, but I guarantee you I'm going to be in no mood to be live streaming, much less sitting in this chair after that round of indignities. So,
well, you know, I got to tell you my prostate exam. So I go in and I'm getting, as it turned out, I had a bad thing with diverticulitis last year. I had a call.
Right.
It was horrible. Anyway. So it kind of hurts here on the lower left side. So anyway, someone talked to me in the band, I don't know, somewhere in my travels, and they said, that's your prostate. So I kept feeling the pain down here. So I went in and I got like about 5 prostate exams within probably about a year or something. So about the 5th time, the doctor said, where exactly? I said, it still hurts. It's my prostate. He goes, where exactly does it hurt? I go, down here. He goes, your prostate. Is we got to check it up your ass, man. That's something else entirely. So I had 5 prostate exams because I listened to some asshole who told me that was my prostate in front. It might have been sick, Rick. I don't know, but it was horrible.
Oh, my God.
The doctor laughed out loud, man.
That is a Danny Vapid move.
Oh, man. So
a couple of years before my dad died, he and my mom came out, and I had just had a prostate exam.
And, oh, boy.
And my doctor's a big man with big hands.
Oh, boy.
You know? And he went a little, I don't know if there was a shortage or what, but he went a little easy on the loop. And I'm telling you, man, I don't know if I ended up with a fucking fissure up there or just a big hemorrhoid, but my ass was killing me for like 5 days. And I'm telling my dad about this. I'm like, boy, man, that doctor really, like, you know, he should have been a lot more generous with the lube. My dad goes, did he have both hands on your shoulders?
Yeah. Jeez, I know. I remember looking at this book. It was a physician assistant guy that kept doing it, giving the exams. I was looking at his fingers. I was like, it's bigger than my dick. Jesus Christ. This is horrible.
No. I mean, I could make a joke, but people would take it wrong. So I'm not going to. But the last one wasn't bad, thank God. And so next week there's going to be no live stream, most likely, because they dope you up and you end up tired all day. I need me time. I gotta curl up into a fetal position, hug myself, cry, all that kind of stuff. If you have questions, okay. So here's a couple questions for Joe King. What is the key? I love this. CD Hansen, again, the guy from Sacramento. Now he's got like 8 questions. What is the key to writing memorable pop songs? What is the key to writing good choruses?
Stay in the key of G, Chris. Key of G. That's right.
Because here's the thing. There's no magic. It's like, do the, oh, that's the thing. I've been getting it wrong all these years. That's the one thing. It's not going to happen, man. That's not how it works. It's, you know what the key is to writing good choruses or to writing good pop songs is write a lot of songs. You know, first of all, have talent. And second of all, write a lot of bad songs and put in your 10,000 hours. Work really, really hard at it. Listen to a lot of music. Don't just listen to... The problem is that I see with a lot of bands, it was like that band we did a Song Doctor thing for a couple weeks ago. It sounded like the only records they'd ever listened to in their life were Screeching Weasel and the Queers. We're not gonna... You gotta have a better grasp on rock and roll than that. If you're going to do something interesting, you got to dive into a whole bunch of different things. And if you're doing it right, because there's a lot of borrowing in pop and rock music. So this idea of originality, people get it all wrong. They think they got to do something no one's ever done before. That's kind of true, but it's by taking pieces of things that have been done before and filtering them through your personality. I think... And Joe, you can disagree if you like, but I think it's especially true of Joe and the Queers. I think the key is A, have talent, but also put that through your personality. You know, allow your personality and your quirks and whatnot to come through, and then you create something memorable. There might be a lot of people who are more successful and more popular than you, but your fans will never leave you. Because you're doing something that they sense is genuine, because it is.
Yeah. Well, see, that gets into, like, number one, you know, our influences, me and you, go way back. Joey Ramone, Gigi Allen, who I knew, me and him, we connected because he was into the Monkees and Paul Revere and the Raiders.
He was up from your neck of the woods.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, I knew him way back then. And he was a great drummer.
Before he was Gigi.
Basically, he was a wimpier dude than we were. And, but... You know, our influences went back to Del Shannon, Turtles, you know, way back the 50s, Chuck Berry, the Stones, all that stuff. So you get those influences. But, you know, even now, the other thing, though, I think gets into the whole where you are in life. I was telling Nicotine, the thing is, when Screeching Weasel started, or the Queers, or, say, Mighty Bosstones, the Muffs, Green Day, the Ramones, there was no safety net under us. It was like either welcome to Burger King, can I take your order, or playing music. And it was, like you said at best, it was a loser proposition. I mean, come on, really? It was a loser proposition to play music. And then now you go, these people are in bands and they look like, I was into Dee Dee Ramone, Lou Reed, On Heroin, David Bowie, Mick Ronson, you know, Keith Richards. And now these guys look like, you know, they're worried about their damn credit score. And making their car payments on time. And I was like these people that lived on the edge and like looked off the cliff, you know, and they're like teetering on the edge. And I think that brings a little to the table too.
In defense of people who are doing it today, that's not rock and roll anymore. And it hasn't been for a long time.
Well, sure.
You know, for better or worse, it's just, it's not like that anymore. It's like anything else. It grows up. And when it grows up, it loses something of what made it interesting.
Yeah.
You know, the problem from my perspective with punk in particular is that it grew up and became not only less interesting because of all those reasons, but also so much was revealed about how empty it was musically. I mean, you can dress stuff up quite a lot with attitude. And when you strip it of all its attitude and you make everything politically correct, then all you're left with is the music. And the, you know, the realization I came to is these bands just aren't very good. They don't hold up very well, most of them.
Hey, man, when we opened up for the Ramones that time, Joey said it best, Johnny too. You know, we opened up for the Ramones when Richie was drumming in 86. We played every song. We were horrible. We played every song we knew in about five we didn't, you know, we didn't know how to open up with those 4,000 people there. Never mind, we never played in front of 400, never mind 4,000. I was shaking like a dog passing a peach pit. And Joey said, hey, listen, when you open up for bands, play your best 22 minutes, get off stage. He said, most bands only have one or two good songs anyway. I remember laughing about that. I never forgot that, you know? So,
well, I finally wised up in the early 90s, and I was into those. I think we did a tour with you guys when we did it. I was into the 30-minute sets, but already in 93, we were on tour with you guys. So already in 93, there were people complaining about that. And I was like, look, man, if we go out, we had four records out, four LPs out at that point. I said, if we go, and we played nothing off the first one at that point. So I said, if we go out and we do 30 minutes, we're forced to do a greatest, there's no fap. We're forced to do a greatest hit set, essentially.
Yeah.
It has to be all of our best songs. Like, you shouldn't be complaining.
Right, right, yeah. I mean, your set back then when you were touring, I mean, it was not, as a fan, I was like, dude, remember when we played at McGregor's? It was less like when I jumped on stage drunkenly. That was like every song was amazing, though. You guys didn't have any filler, but not many bands these days are like that. And Joey told me that too. You got to be your own worst critic and you got to be honest with yourself. And he told me, he's like, dude, I don't need to read the New York Times to know if it's a good song or not. But I think a lot of these bands, they'll get on whatever label or something and sell some CDs to a bunch of jocks at the Warped Tour, and they think, you know, they believe their own bullshit. They suck, you know. So I don't think there's enough honesty in music today. That's my take on it, anyway. So,
well, I mean, I don't know. I don't know. I guess, you know, it's funny because you get old, and people are like, you just sound old when you talk like that. But me and Joe were talking like this 25 years ago, so.
True. So, yeah. But, you know, I picked up on what you said. This was a few years back now. But I listened to, like, a lot of different – I'm like you. I got away from – you know, I used to listen to Black Flag Damaged all the time. But I really – nowadays, I'll listen to – lately I've been listening to real old stuff like Gene Austin – She's Funny That Way, that, you know, later Sinatra recorded, and Oceana Roll and Billy Murray, I Wonder Who's Kissing Her Now, and I used to play trumpet, so I can read music, and I'm glad I always understood and loved being part of the band with a first, second, third trumpet and trombones and sax, so it really helped me, but also listening to those influences. Nowadays, I've really been getting into ELO, and, you know, I always liked him, and I kind of look at it more as a producer angle, but the songs are, you know, they're amazing and catchy, and I was like, wow, how did they do this on analog tape too, you know? Yeah,
very Beatles influenced.
Yeah, and so I want to get into the keyboard. I found a keyboard player, and so I want to, on our new album, we're going to go that kind of angle and try to do a bigger, just use keyboards more as a rhythmic rhythm guitar, a keyboard like that, and play with sounds like that and kind of do a bigger production and stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I have a great keyboard here that is basically an expensive paperweight because I can't, I mean, I play it, but I can't, like, the technological end of it is so over my head.
Yeah.
And this is a problem with the world we live in today the musicians that are doing the best, the up and coming musicians that are doing the best are all very technically savvy.
Yeah.
And that's just the way things are. It's not, I'm not going to change it. That's just the way things are. But it kills me not just knowing that I can't do that. Like that stuff to me is not written for musicians, these instruction manuals. And,
yeah.
And it's true. Frustrating to me that I can't do it. But I think of all the people like me when I was starting out who are never going to do anything or go anywhere because that's a requirement now. You've got to be able to record your own music. You've got to be able to know how to run a mixer and compressors and all that kind of stuff. And it's like, that's never going to happen for me. So that's something I find unfortunate. Like I said, I'm not going to change it, but I've got this Yamaha Mach 8 here. It, you know, it's got enough power if I sat on it, it would take me to the moon and back, but I can't harness that power. There's very little I can do with it. Luckily, though, Joe, the good thing is that I'm so musically inept that the tiniest little things that I do figure out open up these massive worlds for me, unlike if I actually knew what I was doing and therefore would not be impressed.
Well,
but it's like when you get a new guitar, suddenly you find yourself writing a bunch of songs. You know?
Right, right, yeah. But it's cool because you hear one little lick here or there or whatever, and it'll trigger that the whole a song. I don't know if you're like that, but I was thinking about it the other day, and I always, for years, have had a song kind of going constantly, ideas. I don't know if you pick up on that. Like Nicotine was doing, he was doing his drum parts. He's playing most of the instruments. And I started writing this song. I'm Ready for You. It's kind of like a blues thing. But I always have some song in my head. I don't know what it is. I just...
Yeah, it's funny. That is the kind of thing I think most people, it would drive them insane. Because I walk around... music in my head constantly. I can't stop it. And I mean, whatever, I'm used to it, but I could see it driving somebody completely insane. There's a good short film script in there somewhere. Now somebody wants to know, Joe, do you guys, C.D. Hansen again, apparently he's doing an interview with us. Do you guys do any vocal warm-ups before shows? How does Joe keep his voice from going out being on tour all the time? I do vocal warm-ups, and I have been doing them since I kind of got back into the game back in 08. Joe, I don't know. Do you do warm-ups? How do you keep your voice set on the road? How do you go out and do that without warming up your vocals?
Yeah, I'm on the road so much that it never, cools off. So I don't need warm-ups. But I see some guys do it. I know Joey Ramone said he would use Olbas, those, Fisherman's Friend types of lozenges. But I don't do anything. I don't know. I don't think about it too much, so I'm lucky. My voice, unfortunately, from all the shows, I can't sing as falsetto like I used to, but I don't do any warm-ups, no. It's weird.
Well, I do my warm-ups before the show, And if I don't, I will cough through the first two songs. I'll just start coughing through the first two songs. So, there's nothing I can do that I've found yet that will keep me from losing my voice. And I've told our agent I can't do more than three shows in a row. By the third show, I'm ragged. That's if I'm on complete vocal rest at that point. Because I start losing my voice, and by the fourth show, I sound like crap. I don't know why. I sing from my diaphragm. I finally did learn how to sing correctly, so I'm not, screaming from the throat. But my voice doesn't hold out very long. So, we've talked about, we were talking about doing it this year. It ended up not happening, but maybe for next year, about going out, out east where the drives are short, the cities are closer together, doing 10 shows, and I'm like, that's fine, but we got to make really good money because we need every fourth day off is the problem. Well, or
could you make it with one day off and then jump on another three, or would you need a couple days off?
Yeah, I think I could. Because if you go out, you don't want to give up your weekend. So let's say you go out, you do Friday, Saturday, Sunday, you take Monday off, then you do like Tuesday, Wednesday, then take
Monday and Tuesday off, and then jumping in, Wednesday and Thursday. Well, yeah.
Well, you take Monday off, then you go Tuesday, Wednesday, so you're only doing two shows. You take Thursday off, and then go back Friday, Saturday. So you don't want to give up those weekends. Really, you don't want to give up the Thursday nights either. Those can be pretty decent. But nobody goes out on a Monday night anyway.
No, you're right. I mean, we're hoping, that's right. We'll go out. I would love to go out. I think it would be a ball, but, and that's what's keeping us going is that we're able, when we go with the Dwarves, that's basically what we do. We'll go to a Thursday or Friday till that next Sunday. So it's like, 7 to 9 shows or 10. Right. Dickies are the same way. And we're all having a ball, and all the shows are good, and we're not killing ourselves. That's how they're doing it, though. We have a day or two off during the week.
Well, maybe we can go out on the road next year. I would love to do it now. You do nothing on the road to save your voice.
No, I don't. I'll do
in the course of these 3 days where I'm doing like three shows in a row. I've got Tea with Honey. I've got Thayer's lozenges. I've got the Olbas. I've got the what do they call it? Singer Saving Grace. I mean, you name it. I've got the freaking humidifier. I mean, I've got every. I'm like babying my voice, and it's just still. It's and half the time I end up on vocal rest. I love to talk. It's really hard for me not to talk. And the worst part is, you go on vocal rest, and it's like suddenly everybody's talking to you.
Yeah.
You know I can't talk. Yeah, I'm sitting in the van. You know I can't talk. Why are you talking to me? And you know it's hard for me not to talk. So you know I want to talk back.
People don't understand.
I'm telling you, people don't understand when you go on vocal rest. If you broke your hand and you were like, I can't use my hand today because I got to rest it up because I got a show tonight, people would be understanding about that. But if you say, my voice, like I got to sing tonight and I can't talk, people aren't very understanding about that, I find.
Why don't you hire a midget to sit behind the guitar stack or something and just sing along? I swear, I think the crowd would love to.
I think Jughead already has a job.
Yeah, that's a good. But I think people would love to see you anyway, and no matter, you know, if you weren't singing that well, just wing it. You could probably get up there with a grass skirt and a ukulele and, you know, just, you know, lip sync it, and they'd
well,
get
you know
it.
What made a big difference for me actually was getting the in-ear monitors, and as soon as I did that, it was a world of difference. Those wedges kill you; they kill your ears, and you can never hear yourself. I don't care how good your monitor mix is; it's never anywhere near as good as what you get with those in-ears. Man, it was money well spent because I don't have to push as hard anymore. So that definitely helps.
Well,
and I
you
sing
know,
better. I stay. You know, in key and everything, and my pitch is much better with those.
But, you know, Ben, people just want you, like, I know you'll go to My Brain Hurts and you know, technically pick it apart. People just want Ben Weasel to be Ben Weasel, and Ben Weasel isn't a perfect singer. They don't care. They want to just hear you, warts and all. That's what I think. So I think if you hit a couple of sour notes, it's par for the course. Nobody cares. They just love the passion. They want to see you on stage. So that's my.
I think when you get up there, you've got to, you know, when you're charging, you know, $25-$30 for a show, $35 for a show, you better go up there and kick ass and leave it all there on the stage. I mean, that's my attitude. I want to give people their money's worth. I want to give them, you know, 70 minutes with basically no filler and no very little talking. So I want to give them 70 minutes. I want them to leave really having to think hard if there really is a song that they absolutely had to hear that they didn't get to hear. Because I'm playing, you know, I'm not one of the guys, and this is the other thing that always drove me crazy about my favorite bands. You get these bands who are like, they wouldn't play their hits, or they wouldn't play their great songs. You know, like, I love the Scorpions, man. One of my favorite bands, but they decided to make a change in direction, and their change was awesome. But then all of a sudden they wouldn't play their great songs from the 70s. And even now on their last tour, they did a few of them, but only like partially as part of a medley. That's like,
well,
it's like,
you know,
come on,
my
man,
friend,
these are great songs. You know, the newer stuff is great too. Don't get me wrong. But it always drove me crazy as a fan. And my attitude is, I'm not getting up there to, play my favorite songs. Like, it would be a very different set list if it were my favorite songs of mine. I'm getting up there to play the favorite songs of the people who are paying, and I hate when bands do that. I remember when Jawbreaker opened for Nirvana for like 3 shows. I went to the Chicago show, and I swear to you, they had just had a new album come out after their Big Smash album. They wouldn't play the hit off the Big Smash album. They refused to play it.
Nirvana?
You're in this like 5,000 capacity venue. People have paid an arm and a leg to see you, and you won't play your best known song. I don't get that.
Well, we were out with the Ataris. We've toured off and on the past few years with them, and it was like, at first Chris wasn't playing Boys of Summer. I was like, Chris, man, we're at the level. We got to play whatever hits we've got, man. You got to play Boys of Summer. And then of course they play it, and everybody loves it. But they weren't playing. I was like, Chris, you got to play Boys of Summer, man.
You got to play what people want to hear. I'll tell you something that was funny. When we did a couple shows with the Ataris a couple years ago, and there had been an incident a few years before that where Chris, the singer, the main guy in the band, had lost it on the drummer on stage.
Right,
and
right,
like just kicked him out of the band on stage and like thrown drums at him. And there was this big thing about it, and they put out a video talking about it and stuff. Well, so, and then it turned out like they were playing with us, and I wanted to ask him about it. Well, it turned out that guy was in back in the band, and he was playing bass now instead of drums. And I was really surprised. So I'm backstage, you know, they're about to sound check, or they just sound checked or something. And that guy comes back, and the bass player, the old drummer, and I was like, oh yeah, man, that was awesome when that happened. I was like, you know, everybody in the world has wanted to do that to their drummer at some point. I'm like, you know, you had it coming, buddy. You know, I'm like fucking around. Right.
Yeah.
And so I went back into our room and I thought, you know, I've got this reputation of being a real dick. And I wonder if it's because I do things like that and I don't see fit to tell, like I do it straight faced. Right. I don't like being all jokey about it, like, ha, 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 laughing at my own jokes and like I'm kidding.
So, hey,
so
just,
I went back and I said to the guy, I said, you know, I was fucking around, right? And he's like, oh, man, I'm glad you said something because I didn't know. And I was like, what the fuck?
Yeah. I talked to him. It's Ted's brother, Rob. Yeah, he was just like, you know, they were at the Queers Atari show in New York. They're like, he was, you know, they're all friends. It's like when we were playing the show in San Diego and Dave pulled his debacle drunk and, you know, it was just whatever. If I had
I almost wish I was there because I swear to you, I walk in.
Yeah.
So we're in San Diego playing with the Queers. The Queers play right before us and I'm back at the hotel as usual. I walk in. Now, as I was leaving to go back to the hotel after sound check, Dangerous Dave walks in. And he just seemed off. He just, I couldn't put my finger on it, but I said, hey, Dave, how you doing? And he just kind of went, just kind of looked at me.
Yeah.
Like, that's odd. That's not like Dave. I left. I go back to the hotel, come back to the club, and I had gotten a text from our guy, from our tour manager. Dave went ape shit. Holy fuck. It's all over the internet.
Yeah.
So I walk in and Dave's sitting outside the green room on a couch, just looking like the saddest, most forlorn motherfucker. And he's just like completely alone and sullen, but just like, hey, Dave, rough night.
Yeah.
But yeah, he went bananas and went nuts on stage and was like attacking the other guy. And you're up there and you don't even know what's going on. These guys are going nuts back there.
I was pretending that I was, me and Chris was, Chris Fields was on bass and we were mentally not looking at each other, but we were having a big conversation, you know, and it was like, this bastard, I can't believe he's doing this. We practiced for an hour before we went on stage. So with me singing, Dave's on bass, everybody like gets on the, Chris is taking guitar. We go upstairs, the lights go down, the crowd cheers, those guys are up there, me and Dave go walking up the stairs, and he goes, hey dude, what the fuck? And I go, what do you mean? We're going on, and he goes, you're not playing guitar? And dude, we had practiced an hour, hour and a half before the whole set, everything, and I go, we just practiced, yes, it'll be fine. But Ben, I'm on there playing. And so I'm pretending Dave fell down, but I like pretended I didn't see it and all this.
David had a few too many to drink. This is the this is the part we left out.
But the greatest part was when Hunchback comes out. We're in the middle of the Queer set. I feel a tap on my shoulder. It's Mike Hunchback pointing at Dave, and I go, shit's fucked up if Mike Hunchback is out here telling me shit's fucked up. I couldn't believe it. I laughed my ass off. It was so bad he came out and got me. And at that point, that was when they got in a fight. But
well, I think at that point, Chris had already jumped on Dave and the.
No, it was right before because Mike was like, "Dude, it's so bad." He was like saying, you know, and he was telling me, "You got to get him off stage."
Well, it's a shame. It seems that Dave has been AWOL ever since. You know, I sent him an email right after that happened. And I'm like, "Hey, Dave, we all love you. Shit happens. You know, nobody's. It's not a big deal because you knew he felt bad about it. And it's like, it's not
oh,
a big
I talked
deal.
To
shit
him that-
happens."
I talked to him the next morning. He called up and apologized. I was like, Dave, you've seen me mess up. I mean, come on, who am I? I go, I don't care. No. So what? Everybody made a big deal about it, but I was like, so what? I mean, you know.
It's like, hey, you know, if you were there, you got your money's worth that night.
Exactly. And so it was funny.
Because I think when we went up, I had to throw somebody out of the crowd, like some fucking asshole with a mohawk. You know, nobody told him it's not 1978 anymore, shows up and was like throwing fucking beer at me or something. So I had to have him tossed out, and, you know, he raised a stink about that, and then made a big deal on the internet, of course, as always. So, yeah.
Right. So, yeah, that was.
No, CD Hansen, we don't have any crazy tour stories. You just heard one.
Yes, that's right. You've heard a couple of crazy
ones. Yeah, I mean, I don't know how we got onto the Dangerous Dave thing, but.
He's doing good. He's moved in. I think they were going to buy a house. He's going out, or he's engaged, I think, to a gal who's a veterinarian. Good. So he's doing great. I just, you know, we still talk.
She can give him his shots and things.
Yes. But he's doing good.
But last time I talked to him, wasn't he working or apprenticing or working as a carpenter?
Yeah, that's what he does. He's been working for the same place now. He might be like a, you know, director or something, or a shift leader or something. No, he's been there for a long time. He's got a good gig down there in San Diego.
I'll never forget when I have my own debacle on stage, and he just goes right out. He's on the internet. He's like going off on your booking agent
That's why she quit. He called her CUNC. I think she's going to quit. He goes, I'm not backing down.
Good for him.
I meant to tell you that we played out at KFK, you know, Wound Up Records. We call him Keith, KFK.
Oh, God, I haven't seen that guy in over 25 years. Yeah.
Doing great.
Down in Lawrence, right?
Down in KC. Matter of fact, I met him in Lawrence. Was in Lawrence when we were walking
down
the street.
That place? What was the place down there? It was a place where William Burroughs did some of his shotgun art.
What was the place called?
It shut down.
I can't. It was the outhouse.
That's right.
Oh, dude, check this out. Keith told me there's a great documentary, Google it, on the outhouse. It's cool with all these old punk rockers. Tesco V and like all these, I think Rollins, and it's really cool talking about the outhouse. So Keith told me about that. But anyway, we played a 60th birthday party in August, and B-Face came out and played bass. I guess I told you that, right? Yeah, B-Face. Left the band 25 years ago to go get a six pack of beer and just came back. So, dude, yeah, unbelievable. He didn't skip a beat. B-Face was like on it, man. We had one little practice of a few what we're gonna play, the hotel room, and I just got up there and he didn't skip a beat. It was just like right in the pocket.
So did you guys got along and everything?
Oh yeah. It was fun. Wimpy came out with his girlfriend Anda, and we had a ball. Yeah, it was fun. Anyway, I said, B-Face, if we do some shows with Weasel, you got to come back out. So he said, oh, definitely. So
yeah, good for him.
You know, it would be fun. So he's doing good. So
it was fun.
But I had to laugh, though. He just jumped right in. And, you know, even obscure stuff like gay boy off pro. I've got it down. No problem, dude. We don't have to go over that one. And, you know, we called it right out. He was perfect. So it was kind of funny. So.
All right. Well, do we got any? We don't really have any good questions. All right, Joe. I know you've got to get back to recording and. I've got to finish up. I'm going to see if my wife read my thing and finish that up. Somebody's asking, what about Chris Barrows? What does that mean? That's a question devoid of context.
What about Chris Barrows?
We love Chris Barrows.
Yeah. Chris Barrows has that, finally,
he's been planning it for years, but he has that photo book coming out.
Yeah, that'll be great.
He used to take going back to probably the early 80s, if not the late 70s, he would take photos, like candid photos of people and bands and stuff backstage at clubs down there in Florida. You know, Polaroid photos and stuff. And somebody's publishing this photo book. So he writes to me, he says, hey, would you write a would you write like a foreword for it? The publisher insists that it's got to be somebody who has published books. And I'm like, Chris, you can't call the things I've written books, first of all. And second of all, they've been out of print for 15 years. And yeah. The reason they're not back in print is because they're terrible and I'm ashamed of them. And he's like, no, they don't care. They just care that you're a published writer. All right. So I wrote this really dickish thing. And you know, he's Chris. And he's like, oh, that's awesome. That's fucking great. You know, but it's just like this completely dickheaded, something along the lines of, you know, the people in these photos are all unattractive and smell bad and, you know, just typical me kind of thing. But I guess that's what he wanted. But Chris Barrows is great. Love Chris Barrows. You know, Chris Barrows, I've known him almost since the band started because our demo tapes were reviewed in the same issue of Maximum Rock and Roll. And we traded tapes or something and we corresponded. And then we would go down to Florida on tour and we'd stay. Remember they had the trailer. He lived in a trailer in Thanota Tassa, Florida, outside Tampa. I mean, this is in the middle of nowhere. It was scary out there, man. That was redneck South out there.
Chris would always put us up. I mean, for years, his sister, ironically, would put us up here in Marietta, her and her former husband,
oh, yeah.
And Lamar. And she lives 1 mile from my house. I just saw her maybe last month. So we're good buddies.
Yeah, her ex-husband wrote like a 1,000-page book on the Kennedy assassination. Have you read that? I tried to read it, but it's so damn long. I just kind of...
A true story, it's like I've had 4 chickens, so the possum killed them. Anyway, Susie's got chickens. She takes care of her neighbors down the street. So anyway, we had a chicken with a tumor on its wing, so we had the vet take off the... take off the tumors thing on a chicken, and Mimi thought I was nuts, but I was like, trust me when I say I've spent $200 for worse things than trying to get
Why didn't you just kill the chicken and eat the chicken?
Yeah, it's
is
just
it an
like,
eating
you know,
chicken or an egg laying chicken?
Oh, it was an egg laying chicken.
So
yeah,
are the egg laying chickens not good eaten?
I don't know. I haven't tried because they kind of become half pets, you know, but I just, whatever. Anyway, so we had got the wing kind of nipped off the tip of it that was cancerous. And then Susie came by to chicken nap. She wanted to chicken sit the sick chicken. So I gave her the sick chicken. And anyway, the next day I hear a ring in the doorbell. I'm over here with a band or something recording. And I look out and there's Susie. Tears flowing with the dead chicken in her arm. The chicken died on her watch. She took it and the chicken died. I mean, if it were, so I told Chris, he goes, I guess it's not a good time for dead chicken jokes. I go, no, not to your sister. So we're out there. I'm practically in tears too because we're burying the chicken because she's just torn
you
up.
You buried the chicken?
So we buried the chicken.
Why did you bury it? It's a chicken.
What else am I going to do with it? I mean, you know, we have to bury them out here. Chickens, they're high mortality rate. But anyway, I'm going to get a possum get in there and ate my other 4 chickens. But I'm gonna get some more this spring when I get back
from
Europe.
Let me ask you this. Have you ever read The Egg and I?
Yeah, that was, The Egg and I. Yes, who did that? That was
Betty McDonald. Her husband, she and her husband buy a chicken farm up in Washington or Oregon or somewhere. And it's all about the chicken farm, and that was the origin of Ma and Pa Kettle, okay?
Yeah, The Egg and I remember we had that book at the house.
Well,
what I learned
from The Egg and I is that chicken farming sucks, number one, and number two, chickens are stupid, mean animals. Those are the 2 things I took away from that book. It's also a very funny book, but those are my takeaways.
My biggest problem was... Bobby from the Riptides works for the Canadian government. They're from Canada. So we call him Chicken Killer because he had years ago gotten a license among, you know, it allowed him to do certain things and among other things was kill chickens. So we call him Chicken Killer. Anyway, I had a chicken that was sick. And so the first time I didn't know how to put the thing down. I didn't want to pay $35 to go kill the chicken and I didn't want to cut its head off. So I went down in the crawl space with my 380 and I shot it in the head.
What the fuck, Jesus, girl?
I didn't know. I was like, shit, dude. And the thing
that
went.
That seemed better to you than cutting the chicken's head off?
Not after doing it, no. It was like sticking an M80 in the poor thing's mouth, but oh my God. So I called Chicken Killer up, and he goes, no, the best thing is to take the snips, the garden pruning shears, and just nip it right off. It'll come right off. He goes, it just kills them instantly. So like an idiot, I go, okay. So after the 380, I wasn't doing that. So instead of just paying my vet $25 to put the thing down, I tried that. Jesus Christ. I am like, I'm not putting any chickens more down. Oh my God.
Right, did it just half come off or something?
Yeah, kind of. And they start flapping around, man. It is a bad scene. It kind of freaks me out.
You would think like that's where the saying comes from, running around like a chicken with its head cut off.
Yeah.
You would think, no, you don't cut off the head because the body's still going to flap around and try to go places.
Yeah, it was a bad scene. I just don't have it in me to kill animals, you know, so Jesus. So next time, I'm going to get more chickens, but I talked to the vet, and he said, just bring it in, I'll put it down for $25. I go, that's far preferable to killing it with a 380 or trying to cut it.
I'll tell you, man, up here, like, it seems like everybody's got a gun rack on their truck. There's a lot of hunting up here, and I think I would be fine with the sitting around bored waiting to shoot something part, and I think I'd be fine with the shooting something part, but I don't want to gut the thing. You know, I don't want to clean it. I don't want to deal with any of that.
Oh, no, that's bad news. No, no way, man. Stay away from it. But
Now, real quick, Haley Crusher wants to know, she has chickens too, and she wants to know if you name your chickens.
They told us not to. We kind of had not, like, you know, Bobby and Lou, but we called it one Brownie, Red, the big one. We kind of, they Peanut, yeah. We said Peanut and Goldie. Yeah, we kind of had nicknames for them, but we didn't get in. You can't treat them like pets because the high mortality rate, they die. You know, we went through a bunch of them. So.
Okay, so one other question about that. Are the fresh eggs really great? Because I've never had farm fresh eggs. Are they really great?
Yes. Yeah, they're great. Ask Haley Crusher. She'll tell you. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. And one other question from a guy here. He says, what was Hopeless's response to the album title Beyond the Valley of the Ass Fuckers?
They just call it Beyond the Valley. Yeah. But there was an album by Plasmatic called Beyond the Valley, but they didn't like it. At that point, they weren't paying. It's not that they have since then either, but, you know, that's why we released did the Punk Rock Confidential live in the studio type thing and the Beyond the Valley live in the studio. So we did those because they didn't care for it. That's why I used two titles with the song titles with the C word in it, you know, because they weren't paying us. So, they didn't care for it too much.
So was that record then just like, I don't give a shit kind of record?
Yes, of course, you know, so, I was like, forget it, man, but, you know, it's so funny, though, a lot of people come up like, man, can you just play this song off Beyond the Valley, and I'm like, okay, I mean, I've seen tattoos of the artwork on the cover and stuff, I mean, these people are really out there, but it's, you know, it has its moments, but they were ripping us off, so.
At least you didn't call it contractual obligation.
I still think you should have called Bark Like a Dog and Out Come the Chihuahuas. Yeah, I thought that was genius.
Yeah, that was the original title since... I
understand why you didn't, but it was a genius title, man. That was a great one.
I didn't think it would age well was my concern with it, but, you know, now I wonder if it wouldn't...
You know, you had it right. You said, but at the end of the day, it's going to cause you endless, you know, hours of defending, you know, back and forth. It would piss off you know who, and it's just like not worth the energy.
I don't care about that. But yeah, it was just, I think part of it was just a fight I didn't want to have at that time. It's like you're with a new label, you got a record coming out you really like, and you want to focus on that. But also, I mean, I really didn't think it was going to, I didn't think that title, it's one of those things, you know, you always got to be careful when you do a joke, especially like a topical joke like that, because it's funny as hell for 5 minutes, but then you got to ask yourself, if the album's still in print 20 years later, is it going to be funny then? Or if it's not funny, is it going to at least be a good enough title to stand on its own. And I guess that's my argument now, is I think even if people didn't understand the reference now, it would be still kind of a funny title.
Oh, it's that's what I said. Even on its own, if they don't know what it's about, it's a great, and out come the Chihuahua, it's a great title. Yeah. And it, yeah, in more ways than one. I was sorry that one. I don't know if you remember, but my vote was for Chihuahuas all the way.
I don't know. But anyway, Joe, it's always wonderful to talk to you. Let's make some music together. The ball is in your court, my friend. Send me the Christmas stuff. Send me anything. I will produce a Christmas record. I will get on an airplane or on a train. I can't get on a boat because there's no river that goes down there. But I will go down to Atlanta. I will work with you. I will do whatever I need to do to make this happen. But, Joe, we got to get one of those great – you're a great songwriter. We got to get one of those great albums out of you of those songs. And we can do different things production-wise. We don't have to do the same old thing. In fact, that would be exciting. But let's do something great. But the first step, you got to demo the songs.
Yeah, I will. You know, why don't you come on down when Richie's here? I mean, he's kind of coming down wide open. Let's have some fun with it.
Depends on when it is. When is it?
He's kind of up in the, you know, like just whenever. I said, dude, I can work spur of the moment. I'm not like, I mean, Richie can too. And you're more grounded, of course, which you should be. But we're like, at, you know, whenever.
I mean, I got the kids. Like May or June I got or the something kids, like and my wife has certain times of the year where she's needed at work, where she can't take off. But if I have advance notice, I can usually swing it. And Richie is awesome. You know, Richie can come in and. He's such a great drummer. I mean, he can come in and knock things out in no time at all.
Unreal.
I mean, he's weird. A good guy, and he's a great drummer.
Ben, remember the show at the Fonda Theater when we hadn't seen Rich in a while? And he came down and sat in with us. It's so weird. We played Creed and Hop, Rockaway, and Sheena. And all of a sudden, I played a million times with our drummers that were great. And then all of a sudden, Richie jumps up there, and it was like, not a little bit better. It was like a thousand times better.
It was unbelievable. It was unbelievable because at that point, I had actually gone out into the crowd, which I never do.
Right.
But I was like up in a balcony or something. I went out because I wanted to hear what it sounded like out there. And it happened to be at that moment when he came up. Oh. And it was unbelievable. It was incredible. Yeah. It was incredible.
Chris Field said the same thing. He's like, dude, I couldn't believe he said it. And Chris is a good drummer. He's like, dude, it went like a thousand times better.
Yeah.
CJ, we played that Reduno thing festival last summer. CJ jumps up to do the encore with us for three songs. And it was the same thing. It's like, I don't know how a bass player just comes up and plays Sheena, but we played it a thousand times better than we normally do. And we do it pretty good. But I don't know how it's because they're pros. It's that.
I thought it was great. Last time we played with CJ, he came up and we sang Lobotomy together, which is just like, I mean, to me, you know, I know there are a lot of people who are like, CJ was later in the band now. Man, he CJ's a Ramon. And to me, that was an absolute honor and a thrill. To be able to, I mean, it's always great to play a show with his band and share a stage, but to have him come onto stage and perform with me, I mean, I was excited because my kids were there. I'm like, kid, I played with the Ramon, and the kids are excited about it.
You know, I was talking to one of the local studio guys, Jeff Bakos, who's kind of an Atlanta legend, works on gear and worked with all sorts of bands as a studio. Anyway, out of the blue, he didn't even know. I wasn't talking about the Ramones. We're talking about punk rock songwriters. And he goes, he mentioned you, and he goes, really, one of the best, greatest songwriters today, current, is C.J. Ramone. I go, yes, dude. Solo stuff is amazing.
Who said that?
My buddy Jeff Bakos from, he's an amp studio guy here, but just out of the blue and just, you know, he didn't even know
my music. I mean, C.J., I think, has worked hard at his songwriting, but I know he's done a record since then, but the record he had done, it wasn't out yet when you guys were up here and he was playing it. It was just... it was head and shoulders above when he was starting out on his own. And there were some good songs on those early, on that first record that he put out, but
he's getting better.
Yeah. He's really improved. And that's a very, very hard thing to do. When you're older, it's a really hard thing to do.
I mean, it's so good. I asked him if I could cover one of his songs just to do it. 'Cause I like singing it. And he goes, absolutely. But you could hear some of those songs Joey singing them. I mean, you could hear that song, Baby, Baby, You're the Only One.
What do you mean? You're out with the guy in a band for years, and at some point, you know, even if it doesn't happen at the time, I mean, that makes an impression on you that's going to stay with you for, well, it's like, you know, you were saying you played trumpet, you know, as a kid. I mean, that musical training, you know, yeah, nothing you do sounds like trumpet music, but these little things, they stick with you and they have an effect, and maybe that effect is really long term, but it makes a difference. You gotta figure being around that, playing those great songs, being in a band where you're playing these, some of the greatest rock and roll songs ever written.
That's true.
And working with the people who wrote these songs and seeing them work, you know, in the studio, and that's got to stay with you. That's got to have, if you decide, hey, I want to be a songwriter, I mean, that's got to have an influence on you that goes deeper than just somebody who's listening to the records at home or something. I mean, you've seen how it's done, you know?
So, yeah, exactly. He was there, and, you know, that was the great thing about Richie. He's a great songwriter too. And, you know, the thing with Marky never wrote anything. That's what, another reason I liked Richie. But Richie brought
us. Yeah, the problem with Marky is he's not a songwriter, and I think it was hard for him to do. He's not a songwriter and he's not a singer. And if you're neither of those things, you'd be the greatest drummer in the world. But it's real hard. You know, Ringo Starr went out and sang songs and wrote songs. You might not like him, but he did it. And but. You know, Marky doesn't do that, so I think he's got a little bit tougher. He's in a little bit tougher position. Whereas Richie, when he was in the Ramones, he was writing songs. I mean, "Smash You" is a great. That should have been on the record, man. That was a great song.
Smash You.
I can't believe that didn't make the record.
Yeah, it is. One thing I'll say with Marky, when I played with him, I told him to. I got to give him credit because he would play with different pickup bands. But we would go on stage, I've seen him with different lineups here and there. I haven't seen him in a while. But he would make the bands musically sound like the Ramones most of the time. I was really surprised. Yeah. Lurch saw us, me and Philip played with Marky and some bad singer. And Lurch was out there. It was the last, we filled in end of our tour. Anyway, Lurch was there, who's a good judge. And he was like, dude, you guys sounded like the Ramones musically. I couldn't believe it. And that's from Lurch. He was serious for once. And so I got to give him credit because, you know, I'm not saying Richie couldn't do it.
No, Marky's a great drummer. Don't get me wrong. But I'm just saying, I think it's a lot harder to be in that position and try to create a really successful solo career than it is if you're a front man or, you know, Richie gets out there and sings, you know, he gets up there in front of the mic, and CJ writes songs and sings, you know, they're at the front of the stage. And it's a lot easier when you're doing that to build an audience.
Yeah, Richie just played a few months ago here in Atlanta, and it was great. And he gets up there, he does his thing, he's playing. I think one of the guys was sick, so who would have been drumming. So Richie sang and drummed. I mean, the guy's amazing. Yeah, I had a couple beers in him too, man. It was like, dude, I was watching him close. He didn't skip a beat. Then he gets up, someone else jumped from the opening band, drummed. He got up there saying, then he walks out in the crowd, he's signing stuff. Well, the band's still playing. It was pretty cool. Then he's high-fiving, taking pictures. Then he jumps out. He really made it was a fun show. It was really fun. Yeah. He did great, man. People love him. But you know what? I remember that guy from back when we knew him years and years ago, and he hasn't changed a bit. He was the same way. He's nice as pie. He never had an attitude. Of course, none of the Ramones really did with me. So I never saw
those
guys.
The lesson that I got from the Ramones in terms of, you know, obviously there are a lot of musical, but in terms of how to do my business, the thing that the takeaway there, and it's the same I think you can take away from a band like Motorhead, any of these bands that just are almost kind of niche bands in a way. They may be pretty popular, but they've got they've got some really hardcore fans and they never really broke through to the mainstream. The thing you learn from the way they conduct themselves is the fans are your bread and butter. The fans are the most important things. You can't really be doing it for people in other bands or record labels or industry people or whatever. You've got to put the fans' interests first. So when you go out, you make a record or you go out and do a show, you've got to think like a fan. You've got to think, what would I want to see?
Yeah.
You know, if I was going to see the Ramones, what would I want to hear? Or if a new Ramones record was coming out, what would I want to hear? Well, it's the same thing when I think of my band. Like, what would I want, you know, if I was a fan of my own band? And that's how I think you're supposed to do it. I think that's how you maintain that connection. And, you know, people wonder, how do you keep doing it? How do the Queers keep going out? You play, you know, 120 shows a year. We've been doing it forever. We don't play nearly that number of shows, but we've been doing it for, it's like, how do you do it? How do you maintain that audience? I think, and I've seen it with you for decades now, it's that thing of having a connection with the fans where you're not really copping an attitude with them and acting like you're better with them. You're better than them. You're not taking shit from them either, by the way, but it's that attitude of, you know,
yeah.
This was something that we fell into because we were weirdos, we were outcasts. Like we were talking earlier about Jack Stevenson and Pandemonium. I mean, this is just sort of a strange, you know, we're fringe kind of people. And those are our people. Our people are the freaks and the outcasts and the losers. They're not the cool kids who are on, you know, Fat Records or,
that's you right. know,
playing all the cool festivals and all that yeah. kind of stuff. And that has value. That has currency because it's so rare, I think.
Well, I was telling Nicotine earlier today, actually, about walking down the street with Joey, not that I was best friends with him at all or anything, in New York City. He was coming to our show, and some drunk fan came up, and you know, I was like, how do you, you know, someone I would have brushed off, you know, and he graciously, you know, took a photo with a guy and stuff. I said, how do you deal with it? He said, for me, it's not a job. But the thing with the Ramones, you've met few of them, and none of them ever had any attitude. They can't be bothered with an attitude like, then you meet these. So that's how I watch how Joey operated and Johnny. They were truly into it, and they loved their fans. Then I'll meet some dick band or band member from, you know, out west, punk band who sold a few CDs to some jocks on a Warped Tour, and they got attitudes. Yeah. It's sickening, dude. Sickening. And I'm like, dude, I knew the Ramones, and they couldn't be bothered, like, with attitudes. That's not what it's about. It was really refreshing watching them. But I was telling them some last tour, dig this one, man. So this guy comes up to me. He's about 46 years old. And he goes, oh, Joe, I got a message from my friend. He's my best friend. He couldn't come because he's got a job. He's got three kids now. He said, he wrote to me back in the day. Remember when we would get P.O. Box 62? We'd all get stacks of, remember? I would answer every one.
Oh, yeah.
And this kid wrote to me, and apparently he was suicidal. And anyway, his friends tell me this just a few months ago. He said, you wrote him back, and he was suicidal, and he said he was going to kill himself. I wrote him back, gave him my phone number, and wrote like four pages, apparently. I don't remember the kid calling me. But this guy told me, he said, I am his best friend. He's got three kids, a loving wife, everything. He was going to kill himself. He wanted me to tell you that because you wrote to him, he did not commit suicide because he was going to go kill himself.
Yeah.
But he wrote to a bunch of bands and nobody wrote back. He said, you were the only one who wrote back and took time to write four pages. And he said, I'm worth, you know, I mean, the guy was practically in tears. And he said, you wrote to that guy and that saved his life. He said, Joe, I am not kidding you. The guy's like teary-eyed telling me. And I go, whoa. And he said, he wanted me to tell you that story and make sure that you knew that. And I go, hey, man, you know, that's the important stuff. How do you put a price tag on that?
Yeah,
you know,
I mean,
what I mean? It's like unreal, dude.
It's really, you know? You know, when you think about the effect that music has had on your life and how much of it is a soundtrack to your life, to your experience, and you realize that you can have that effect for other people. It's tremendous. It really is a gift, and you realize that you're blessed to be able to do this for a living. Now, that's not a license for people to cross the line and to get obnoxious with you. And unfortunately, some people feel it is, especially when they've had a few too many beers in them. But
yeah.
But it is I find, you know, and I have always found this once I got out of the punk ghetto, you know, like the scene ghetto. I found that overwhelmingly the fans are really nice and they're respectful and they're decent. It's only, you know, occasionally you'll get a jerk, but most of them are very decent and nice and friendly and they understand boundaries. And honestly, like, you know, because I've had people in my own bands like, geez, dude, you got, you know, you're wiped out. You really want to go out and sign things and pose for photos. Like, hell yes, I do, man. I've got one of the only jobs in the world where I get paid a bunch of money to stand up and sing my idiotic punk songs. And people sit there and applaud me and tell me how great I am. And then they want to shake my hand and tell me how great I am again and take photos with me and have me sign. I'm like, how can you ever, I don't ever get tired of that. I never get tired of it.
Yeah, no, I know, that's great, but I mean, you know, the fans, after that whole debacle down at South By happened, we went out about 3 weeks after that, and so me and Dave were ready for trouble, because we were like, me, you, Chris Barrows, and Dangerous Dave on one side, and Pixie, and the rest of the world on the other, right?
Yeah.
And you know what, dude, that was a big tour for us, and everybody came out of the woodwork. Not one person was against you. So many people came out of the woodwork. They said, Joe, please tell Ben we want him to play. Tell him we're on his side. Yeah. And I'm telling you, the tour was huge. And it was all people coming down to show support for you. Yeah. And Dave and I talked and we were like, dude, not one person, man, was against
you. I mean, what you find in a situation like that, those situations, it turns out, are a blessing because, first of all, you find out who your friends are and who they're not. But you also find out who your fans are and you realize, holy cow, like the people who are with the biggest mouths are people who wouldn't spend a dime on my band. Anyway, they're not fans.
No, exactly.
They're not people who were coming to my show. They're people who maybe were interested in the band 15 years ago, but they outgrew us. We're not cool enough anymore. You know, who were never fans in the first place. So it's like, I tested the waters and went out and it's like, not only did we not do worse? We did better.
No, I know.
We were drawing bigger crowds. We were making more money. I was like,
I know.
I thought my career was over, internet. What happened?
What's the thing they say with the old-time performer or politician said, don't look back, don't apologize. Never look back, never apologize. I don't know. It might have been Trump or something.
You know what? It's like this guy in Virginia. I don't like the guy's politics necessarily, at least the only thing I know about him is that weird abortion thing, which really rubbed me the wrong way. But I'll tell you this, I admire him for not resigning. You know, I admire him for basically saying this has to stop at some point. And really, what would have happened if he resigned? Because his lieutenant governor, who would have taken over him, he was embroiled in this alleged sexual assault scandal. Like somebody came forward, said he sexually assaulted them. Then a second person came forward. Then the guy who would have been third in line, he had some scandal that was going to, you know, some Me Too scandal that was going to prevent him. It's like, where does this stop? So it's not about politics, but I just admire the guy for saying, no, I'm not stepping down. And you know what? Nobody's talking about it anymore because the guy in Chicago pretended that he was attacked by Trump lovers, and that took over, that made the whole thing disappear. That's what you got to do. You got to say, you know, if you did something wrong, you say, I did something wrong, but I'm not going to, you know, this is a problem. When you have an intensely moral society without grace and without mercy, this is what you end up with. You know, people want to blame religion. People want to blame Christianity for all these evils. But the truth of the matter is, we're living in a very Christian society that's forgotten the concept of grace, and that has forgotten the concept of mercy, and that has forgotten the concept of forgiveness. And we want everybody to kind of do the perp walk and to grovel. And if they don't do it, you know, they just ruin your career. But what you learn is if you just stand firm and say, I don't care, guess what? They can't ruin your career, believe it or not. They can't. Yeah, the one place where you're screwed is if you work for somebody else who gets scared and is going to fire you. But if you're not in that position, you don't need to worry.
Right. You know, I honestly think, not to get into pro-Trump, anti-Trump, or anything like this, I don't even want to go there, but I honestly think if Trump was around maybe 15 years ago, I think every punk rocker would have loved his attitude and everything, you know, and said, oh, he's going against the grain and blah, blah. Like Johnny Rotten came out, I love Trump because of his punk attitude. And I was like, I thought he would, but now in this PC age, they hate him. But I just, his attitude is funny like that, but you know, you can't say that really because people are like, oh my God.
No, you can't. I mean, that's one of the reasons people say I'm a Republican, because I was like, I like Sarah Palin. Like, how can you like Sarah Palin? I like her attitude. At that point, I knew nothing about her politics except that A, she was a Republican, and B, she was a Republican who in Alaska stood up against her own party a lot of the time. That's all I knew about her. But I was like, I like her attitude, man. She's got balls. Plus, she's a good looking woman. And it's the same with Trump. Is that, you know, Trump, I never liked Trump. Couldn't stand him. Didn't vote for him. He gets elected. I'm like, ah, this guy. And then I saw how he was driving the lunatics crazy, and I began to feel sympathetic towards him, and I began to like him. I mean, I can't really say I like him, but I kind of get a guilty little kick out of it when he tweaks people, because frankly, they're the people who deserve tweaking. They're the people who take themselves and their issues so unbelievably seriously. Because if you actually look at what Trump is doing policy-wise, there's plenty to complain about, but no more than any other president.
That's just what I told Nicotine today. I said, like every other president, there's some stuff I like, some stuff I don't like.
Right.
You know, business as usual.
If you take away all the theatrics and all the drama and just look at what the guy's doing on the job, it's business as usual. And maybe that's a bad thing, but to suggest, you know, that, oh my God, you know, and this is how you end up with these guys faking attacks, because they believe in their heart of hearts, America is this way. And it's like, but it's not happening to me, so I've got to make it happen. Because even though it's not true that it happened, it's true in a larger sense. You know, this is what we come across when we see these people who make up lies about, you know, not that it happens a lot, but it happened, like the Duke lacrosse thing. And it's like, yeah, that actually didn't happen, but it's still true in a larger sense. No, it's not. We have to be able to figure out what's true and false. My God, you know?
No, and they can't, you know, I said, you know, what was the quote? You know, a lie will travel halfway around the world before the truth even puts its shoes on. Right. And it's so true today. It's like, come on, they just, you know, the mainstream media is just full of this. I mean, I'm a liberal left wing. I'm so far to the left, I'm off the cliff, and they call me a right wing wacko. You know, it's just like, my God, you can't even have a different opinion. But I honestly think if Obama had gone over to North Korea, which I thought it was great when Trump sat down with the Kim Jong-un, and I said if Obama had done that, they would have loved it. But, you know, they can't.
Well, things have sure quieted down over there since that all happened, I'll say that.
Hey, at least he met with him. That was one thing I agreed with. And so, but anyway.
But be that as it may, I mean, you know, the point to me is not, I'm not interested in the policy stuff. I'm interested in how people behave. And I loved that Sarah Palin drove people nuts. I love that Donald Trump drove people nuts. And if that bothers people about me, then I would say, guys, you got to look at my career. You got to look at who I am and what I've done throughout my career. Cause that's me, the instigator. That's, to me, that was punk rock.
That's right.
And, you know, attacking the sacred cows, and just not because you were trying to change the world, but just frankly for the sake of doing it. And maybe that's not a thing worth doing, but let's at least not pretend that wasn't a pretty common attitude once upon a time. So Joe, I know you've got to do your thing, and I got to do my thing. I want to thank you for spending time with us. I know that the fans love it. I know you haven't seen it, but in the chat, they're all going bananas. They're excited that you came on, and I hope you will join me again sometime on this stream. And in the meantime, dude, send me some demos. Let's do some music together.
Yeah, I will. I'll call Richie, too. But anyway, yeah, tell Sarah we said hi. Mimi says hi. I'll talk to you soon. I'll send that demo next week.
I will. Okay, good to talk to you, my friend. I'll see you later.
Okay, brother. Bye.
All right, bye-bye. All right. Let's see, how do I get back over to my webcam? I don't know how I get back over, but I'm done. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. I will not see you next week. I will see you the week after. Remember, you can subscribe. You can subscribe just by subscribing, or you can subscribe with Twitch Prime by hooking up your Amazon Prime account. You get one subscription per month. Why not make it My Right with Ben Weasel? Thank you so much for joining us. And how the heck do I get out of here? Oh, there it is. I was missing my button. I always love talking with Joe. I'll see you all in 2 weeks. So long.